understand about sockets if you compare it with a pipe. So as far as a pipe is concerned, it has got some features, right? Pipe has got some features. What are the, can you say at least one feature of a pipe? When pipe is used as an IPC or inter-process communication, what is actually one feature of pipe? It's actually following FIFO. Then another major, I mean, in comparison to socket, yeah, it's unidirectional. That is one important property of pipe. That is, it's unidirectional. The flow of data is unidirectional. Even though it is having two ends, the communication will be unidirectional. That is, at one particular time, one end will be acting as a sender or receiver. Okay. It cannot receive and transmit at the same time. So that's why we can say it as a unidirectional kind of communication that we have in pipe. Suppose if we need bidirectional communication, and we can use the pipe concept only. You just think of a case where you need bidirectional communication. At the same time, you are using the pipe function. So what will be the solution for that? The question is, you are having the pipe concept or you are using the pipe function for having the inter-process communication, and you need bidirectional communication also. So in that case, what will you do? What will be the solution? Yeah, obviously you will have to use two pipes. That is actually the solution for that. You will have to use two pipes in that case. So in comparison with that pipe concept, and we have seen several functions for that also. Pipe use in the number of functions in the number of conditions. So if you compare with that, sockets provides a device-like mechanism for bidirectional communication. That is actually the difference between sockets and pipes. Sockets is a concept, or it's like a, you know, device-like mechanism which provides us with bidirectional communication. That is, communication is possible in both directions. So in need for sockets, what are the need for sockets? Obviously, one of the disadvantage of pipe will become the need for sockets for inter-process communication. So in case of pipe, it was like we'll be using that for inserting the byte stream by a process. That is, we'll be having two processes. One process will insert the byte stream into the pipe, and the other process on the opposite side or on the other end will read and delete the bytes. That was actually the process, right? In the case of a pipe, there will be two processes between which the communication is to be established. One process will write the byte stream, and the other process will read it and delete it. Right. One process will write and send, and the other process will read and delete. So that is actually the process happening in pipe. Okay, so that itself is a disadvantage. That is, we cannot have two-directional or bidirectional communication in case of pipe. So that becomes a need for, that in fact raises the need for sockets. So if you are considering two processes, say A and B, and we need that, in case of sockets, we need that A and B ID should be there, that is the process ID, or address information when communicating must also be specified either for the destination alone or for the source and destination both. That is, it's considered as an analogy is also to be mentioned, like letter. Like if you are writing a letter to a person in another house, if you are, you know, you are staying in house H1, say, staying in house H1 and you are sending a letter to another house. And in that case, you can, you will have to send a letter by specifying the name of the person in the other house, right? You will have to specify the name of the person. And obviously, you will have to specify the address also. So if we are providing the address information along with the data that we are sending, so that is actually a concept of socket. So in socket, we will be using the address information also to where or which process that we are actually sending the data. That information is also included in the data that we are sending. So that information, in the sense, if two processes are communicating, they must be specified either for the destination alone. Either the address of the destination alone can be mentioned along with the data stream, or the address of both the source and destination, similar to that of a letter. Sometimes in your letter, you will be writing to address and from address, right? In a similar manner, when you are sending or when you are using socket kind of a function for communicating between two processes, along with the data, you will be providing either the address of the destination alone, or you will be providing the address of source as well as the destination. Okay, so we need a protocol for this, right? We need to define a protocol. So no such protocols were required in case of pipe. In case of pipe, we never talked about any protocols or rules for communication. But here in this case, that is in the case of sockets, we need to set some protocols for communication. Protocols, I mean, all these details you will be learning in your higher semester, that is in your 7th semester, you will be having computer networks. You will be learning all these details, I mean, all these things in details. But just for your understanding, we can have different protocols while we are in a communication of in internet itself. We will be having different protocols like TCP, that is transmission control protocol, then UDP, user datagram protocol, like that. So these protocols are the rules that have been set for communication. So in socket, it requires certain protocols for communication, whereas in case of pipe, we doesn't require any sort of protocols. We will just send the data. We will write the data in the message. I mean, we will write the data and it will be read on the other end by the receiving process. Here, we require a protocol for that. So what is the nature of that protocol? A protocol, for example, provides along with the byte stream, that is along with the data, information of the address or port of destination. You remember the terms, information of the address or port of the destination. And this information is actually provided along with the data byte stream. Along with the byte stream, we are actually providing the information of the address or port of the destination, or addresses of ports of source and destination, both. In the first case, it was address or port of destination. Second case, addresses or ports of both source and destination. And the third case, providing the addresses and ports of both source and destination in case of remote processes. So these three can be considered as different protocols, right? In the first case, in the first protocol, we are actually providing the data byte stream. Along with that, we are providing the information of the address or port of destination matram address alling port. Okay. Another protocol is that we will be providing the addresses of ports of both source and destination. And the other case is that the addresses and ports of both source and destination in case of remote process. So these three can be considered as different types of protocols. And this is actually the rule that we are setting. We cannot transmit the data alone. We will be providing the address details or address information along with the data stream. So that concept is actually what we are using in case of a socket. Right. Okay. So, for example, I have mentioned that UDP, that is User Datagram Protocol, is a connectionless protocol. Remember that it's a connectionless protocol. You will be having both connection-oriented protocol as well as connectionless protocol. I will just help you with an example for that. See, TCP is a connection-oriented protocol. That is, a connection has to be established before the data is been transmitted or transferred between the two processes. You just think of this thing. I mean, I'm mentioning about protocol. That is the rule that we are setting for transferring the data. What is the ultimate principle behind the rule? The address information has to be transferred along with the data byte. That is the first thing. And in which all ways we can transfer this address information? That I have mentioned over here. You are having three different ways. Among that, consider UDP, that is User Datagram Protocol. It is, in fact, a connectionless protocol. That is, a connection need not be established between the two processes. Suppose you are having two processes, A and B. A connection need not be established between the two processes for the transfer of data. Such an example is UDP or User Datagram Protocol. Okay, there is another type, which is Transmission Control Protocol, that is TCP. So in that case, it is actually a connection-oriented protocol. So if you ask an example, I will search. 1 second. Okay, I am just giving an example for differentiating between the UDP, that is User Datagram Protocol, and TCP, Transmission Control Protocol. UDP, that is a User Datagram Protocol, is actually a connectionless protocol. In case of TCP, that is a Transmission Control Protocol, it is considered as a connection-oriented protocol. Suppose you are having two houses. We can take the same example. Consider two houses. You are having two houses. Okay, house one, that is H1 and H2. And you need to have a communication between these two houses. Okay, this is just an analogous, analogy, not a proper example for that. For clear understanding, I'm just mentioning this. And you assume that you are having a river in between these two houses. You're having a river in between these two houses. Okay, so in that case, you can send the data, or if you need to transfer some data, either you can connect or establish a bridge in between these two. You can establish a bridge in between, right? And after that, you can send the data over the bridge so that you can ensure that the data that is being transmitted will reach the destination in a correct manner, right? Assume that you are having two houses, okay, H1 and H2, and there is a river in between these two houses, and you need to transfer some piece of information from H1 to H2. In one way, you can either create a bridge across this river and then transfer whatever the information be. Suppose it be a letter. You need to transfer this letter. You can carry the letter over the bridge and you can reach your destination. So in that case, the advantage is that the efficiency or reliability is more. Since you have the connection established over here, you are pretty much sure that the data that you need to send will reach the destination, right? Since you are having a bridge across the river connecting these two houses, you are pretty much sure that your letter will reach the house H2 if you are transferring it through the bridge. Suppose if there is no bridge, that is, there is no connection between these two houses, and you are by some other means, you assume that you are transferring a letter or transmitting letter with the help of a drone. Okay, you are transmitting the letter with the help of a drone across this river, which is carrying the letter across this river to this side. You will be having different houses over here. Okay, you will be having some more than one house over here. So if a drone is actually transmitting without, we are actually not having a bridge. There is no connection between two houses, and a drone is actually carrying the letter to the house H2. So in that sense, you will not be 100%. You cannot rely on that in a 100% manner. You cannot assure that the letter will reach the destination in a proper way. Similar to that, this is just an analogy. You need not compare it with the UDP and TCP. I'm just telling this for your understanding. In a similar way, in case of UDP, is analogous to transmitting the letter with the help of some other means, like by using a drone or something like that. In case of UDP, we are transferring the data in that manner. That is, it is not connection oriented. It is a connectionless kind of a protocol. You need not have a connection between the two processes for initiating the transfer process. That is UDP. Whereas in the case of TCP, that is Transmission Control Protocol, it can be considered as a connection-oriented protocol, similar to this analogy where we have connected a bridge between the two houses. The advantage, what is the advantage of connecting a bridge? You can assure that the data that you need to transfer will exactly reach the house two. That is, if you're having two systems or two processes, you can assure that your data will reach the destination if you're having the connection-oriented protocol called TCP. So it's just a comparison in terms of their reliability. There are many advantages for UDP also. You can take that example also. Suppose you need to create a bridge, that will take much time, right? In a similar manner, connection-oriented protocol, that is TCP, is time-consuming. It will take much time. First, you need to establish the connection, and then only you can transfer the data. In UDP, you will take less time also. So that can also be considered as a comparison. And all these things you will learn in your computer networks in S7. Okay. We are having UDP and TCP. That is, sockets is basically a protocol-based kind of a communication. Okay. Then another thing that you need to understand here is the concept of ports and addresses. You might have heard about IP addresses, right? IP addresses നിങ്ങൾ കേട്ടിട്ടുണ്ടാവില്ലേ? IP addresses of your system, you might be aware of that. Yes. So there is a concept called attacism. While I was reading that, I have mentioned two terms, right? What was that? Address or port of the destination, right? Two terms were there, address or port. So you need to be aware of that concept. What is address and what is port? Suppose you this again, for this again I will be using another example. Suppose you are searching or you are typing a website name and pressing enter on your system. You are typing a website name and you are pressing enter. What is actually happening? You will actually behave like a client, and that particular website will be the server. A client-server communication has to be established, right? If you are typing google.com in your, you know, in that space provided at the top of your web page in a model, like google.com type in, what you are actually doing is you need to access the Google server, right? You need to access the Google server. So it's actually a client server kind of a communication. So your system will be having an IP address. Your system will obviously be having an IP address. That is an identity of your system. Along with that, if you are using multiple web pages, suppose if I am using another page and I am using another page for another access. In the same system, I can use multiple pages in your web browser, right? You need not have a single page. You can access multiple pages. So when you are accessing multiple pages, what happens? Your IP address remains the same, right? You are having a single IP address, but you need to differentiate between the different pages also. Clear? You need to differentiate between the different pages that you have opened in your web browser. In your web browser, you can add multiple tabs. Same concept. Your IP address will be a fixed one for your system. But at the same time, you need to differentiate between the different web pages also. Right? For that, you require port. Port is not a hardware thing. I mean, you'll be having your mic port and all. HDMI port. Mic connect cheyanulla port okay undu aa port alla 3.5 mm port adonnu alla udheshikkunnathu, it's a software kind of a port. It's actually an ID for a particular service. On each tab or on each page of your web browser, you will be requiring different tasks or different processes, right? So an ID will be provided to such task or service. See, for example, you have opened your web browser Google, you have opened your web browser, and in the first page you are trying to access some Gmail or something like that. You have opened another tab or another a tab, and you have typed it like Facebook. You need to access Gmail in one tab and you need to access Facebook in another tab, but your IP address remains the same, right? So when you need to communicate with the server, you need to differentiate between these two applications. So for that, we'll be using port. So the address and port, both are essential. You need the IP address, along with that you need the port address. So that is that concept. So another thing is that you can take another analog, like you would be having your phone number, right? You would be having your phone number, right? For that also, you will be having your area code along with your specific phone number. Namukku oru country code undu 9100 nu varuthu country code. Along with that, you will be using your specific phone number, ningala exact phone number nu parayunnathu. So adu pole thanaanu. So your country code or area code, which can be considered as IP address. Okay, that can be considered as IP address. And what is port? Your specific port number can be considered as port. So that is how you differentiate between the port and the address or IP address. Korchengil clear ano? What is the difference between the port and the IP address? IP address will be fixed for your system at the time you are, you know, functioning with the internet. Are you able to understand? Okay, some differences, I mean, some issues will be there, obviously. No problem. We will go further. Now, for example, UDP or user datagram protocol is used as a connectionless protocol. UDP header consists of source port. Now you know what is port is. Source port and destination port numbers, length of the datagram, and checksum. Checksum is actually a kind of error checking mechanism. Namukku oru error check cheyanulla oru mechanism aanu checksum nu parayunnathu. We will deal with that. So UDP header will be consisting of source and destination port numbers, length of the datagram, that is how much length is there for your data that you are going to transfer, and then the checksum, which is usually an error checking mechanism. Yes, port means a process or task for specific application that I have mentioned. If you are using multiple pages, all these pages will be for performing different tasks, right? So port means a process or task for specific application. Port number specifies the process. Datagram means a data which is independent, need not in sequence with previously sent data. Checksum is sum of bytes to enable checking of erroneous data transfer. Then TCP is a connection oriented protocol that is also mentioned, but TCP is transport control protocol, which is actually a connection oriented protocol. I think we can directly move to the functions, that will be better. So similar to that of a pipe, we are having some functions over here. So remember that in sockets, you need to remember it's a bidirectional type of communication. It is a protocol based communication, that is a protocol has to be defined. One such protocol is UDP, that is user data protocol. Another protocol is TCP. And this is particularly being used in client server communication. Client server communication sockets use here. And these are all the features, and you can see some of the functions that we use in sockets. Obviously, like nammle pipe device create ennu parnittu oru function undu adhe pole thanne we are having a socket function which is used for creating the socket. Socket function creates a new socket used for creating a socket. Then connect function, this is used to establish a connection between the client and the server. I have mentioned that the sockets are usually used in client server communication processes. So connect is a function. We have just created the socket with the first function. We have created the socket with the function. You see that we have just created the socket. By using the connect function, we are actually connecting the client and the server. Then the next thing is that we need to assign address to the socket, right? We need to assign a protocol address to the socket. That is actually done with the help of bind function. The bind function assigns address to the socket, or you can say that it makes the socket to have its own address information. The socket should have its own address information. That address is actually assigned with the help of bind. So first use the socket function to create the socket, then connect the server and client by using the connect function, then assign address to the socket with the help of bind function. Okay, let it be client and let it be server. Okay, then you have the listen function that converts an unconnected socket into a passive socket, indicating that the kernel should accept incoming connection request directed to the socket. Nothing much. Listen or introduction, this is actually used to listen the socket for incoming connection, whether any incoming connection is coming, whether any connection is coming or not. That is this function, listen function. This is used at this side. Usually the client makes some request to the client, I mean server. Usually what happens is client will make some request to the server, and server will be providing the information to the client. That is actually what happens. So at the server side, we will be using this listen function. Okay, this function is used to listen the socket for incoming connection, whether any connections are coming or not. For that, we'll be using the listen function. Okay, once we have listened it, what will be the next thing? That should be the accept function. This function is called TCP server. It's called by TCP server to return the next completed connection from the front of the completed connection. Nothing but it is used to accept an incoming connection. You can write it like that. It is used to accept an incoming connection. So the listen function is used to listen if there is any incoming connection or not. Accept function is used to accept that particular incoming connection. And then the two basic functions, the send and receive functions. send function is used to send data over stream sockets. Receive function is used to receive data over the stream sockets. And these are the usual functions that we have already used. I mean, write, read functions over there, and we are having send and receive functions. So we have started with socket function for creating the socket, connect function for connecting the server and the client, bind function for assigning address to the socket, and then we had the listen function for listening for any incoming socket connections, accept for accepting the incoming connections, and finally the send and receive functions for sending the data over the stream socket and for receiving the data over the stream socket. And finally, the close function is also there. We'd be, you know, ending that connection. We need to end that connection, and this close function is actually used for that. So nammal oru close function perform cheyyanengil, if it returns zero, it returns zero means a function de value nu parayunnathu, if its value is equal to zero, if its value is equal to zero, it means that we have successfully ended the communication. If the close function is equated to zero, I mean, if you are checking like this, if in bracket you are checking this close function is equal to zero, nammal check cheyyanengil, if it is true, that is, if the value is zero, it means that that communication has got successfully ended. Successful communication aanu nadannu nalladu, you can finalize. If value is a non-zero value, that is, if its value is 1 or minus 1, you can say that it's a unsuccessful communication. Anyways, that communication will be ended. Close function you see my communication ending, but this its value, the value which it returns will indicate whether the communication was successfully ended or not successfully ended. Okay, close function use cheyina nammala communication end cheyan vendiyana, ed communication, the communication between client and server. But if its value is equal to zero, it means that that communication has successfully ended. If its value is some other value other than zero, then you can say that it's unsuccessfully ended. And the case is that communication will be ended. This is just to check whether the communication was successful or not. Okay, these are the functions that you should remember. So what all we have learned in this case? Okay, nammal ippo sockets nokkittunde, we initially compared it with pipe. So when the case of pipe, we had a unidirectional communication. In the case of socket, we had bidirectional communication. It's a protocol based communication. It is usually used in client server type of communication. Then we mentioned about two protocols, that is user datagram protocol, UDP, or TCP, that is transport control protocol or transmission control protocol, where UDP was a connection less protocol and TCP was a connection oriented protocol. And we have seen the differences also. Nammal oru analogy vechittu, we have seen the differences in which case the data transfer is reliable and in which case it's time consuming. All such differences, I mean, some sort of differences we have seen. And choikkanengil, if you have been asked for that, that we have seen. And then essentially you need to look at the functions. So all in, among all these IPC functions, you need to learn the features at first, then you need to learn the functions associated with that with the help of figure. If it's with the help of figure, it's better. These things are all repeating, and also I have mentioned about the difference between the address and port. That is the difference between address and port. That also I have mentioned with the help of an example. So what is basically happening in socket is that we are providing the address information along with the data stream that we are sending. That is the main difference between socket and pipe. In the case of pipe, we are not following any special kind of a protocol or something like that. Yeah, you can. All these points are discussed, right? Socket, client server, socket. And there is only one more concept, that is a remote procedure call. This is a method that is used for connecting two remotely placed functions by first using a protocol for connecting the processes. So initially that is there. First, placing some functions for connecting the processes. It is used in cases of distributed tasks. The real-time operating system can provide for the use of RPCs. This permits distributed environment for the embedded system. The operating system IPC function allows a function or method to run at another address space of shared network or other computer. It's nothing. You're having two systems, you say. You're having two systems or two applications. And we know that in a particular application, will be divided into many tasks. Say you are having n number of tasks. And once you reach executing this much portion of your program, you need the service of another process. Okay, you need the access or you need the service of another process or a remote computer. You can consider it as a client computer, and this can be considered as a server computer. And while executing a program in the client computer, you required or you needed the service of a process in the server. Okay, you are performing a task over here, and this task, while it was doing its execution, it required the service of a task in the server computer. So in that case, we'll be using the remote procedure calls. So the client makes the call to the function that is local or remote, and the server response is either remote or local to the call. That is, the client will be obviously making the call. Client will be making the call, and it will be getting the service from the server. Just help you with the diagram. Let it be your client and it be your server. And we know that while execution happening in client, you needed an access of the server. So initially what you will do, you will call RPC function. You can write call RPC, that is remote procedure call function. Okay. Then that request has to be executed. Execute the request. You can write it. I may not be able to write with that. You can write it. Execute the request. So initial step is that the client actually requests some service from the server. While performing a task, the client requests some service from a process in the server. So it will initially call RPC, that is remote procedure call function. Then you will execute the request. Then it will call the service, execute the request, then call the service, call service, you can write it, call service. Then what happens? Then service execution. Okay. Then you will be having service execution. Okay. Service execution. Then what? That request has got completed and it will return. Similar to that of interrupt. Interrupt in the case, we will be calling the interrupt function. It will be going to the corresponding interrupt handler, and it will return once that execution is completed. Similar to that, you can consider this RPC also, that is remote procedure call. So here in this case, a connection has to be established. A connection is there, or we are using this in client-server communication in case of remote computers. So RPC will be initially called, then execute the request, then call the service, then service execution, then this phase is request completed. Request completed. And finally, it will be returning the reply. And this phase you can write return reply. Call RPC, execute request, call service, service execution, then a request completed, and finally return reply. Client and the server. So this is applicable when a particular task in the client requires a service from another task in the server. Our case is our RPCs. When a particular task in the client requires the service from another task in the server, in that case we'll be actually using the remote procedure calls. Okay, that's it. You can mark your attendance.
Sir, vaiva etra manika?
എടാ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് നിങ്ങൾ 2 മണി തൊട്ട് ഫ്രീ ആണോ അതോ നിങ്ങൾക്ക് 2 മണിക്ക് എന്തെങ്കിലും ഇതുണ്ടോ പ്രോഗ്രാം ഉണ്ടോ? ഇല്ലല്ലോ, 3 മണിക്കാണ് ടൈം. ആക്ച്വലി 2 മണിക്ക് ഓക്കെ ആണ്, 2 മണിക്ക് നടത്താം.
എങ്ങനെയാ?
വി എൽ എസ് ഐ നിങ്ങൾക്കില്ലല്ലോ, ഈ ബാച്ചിനല്ലോ.
അല്ല, സെയിം ലിങ്ക് അല്ലേ ഗൂഗിൾ മീറ്റ്?
അല്ല, അത് കുഴപ്പമില്ല, ഞാൻ സെപ്പറേറ്റ് ലിങ്ക് അയക്കാം, അതിന് പ്രശ്നമില്ല. ലിങ്കിന്റെ പ്രശ്നമല്ല, അല്ല നിങ്ങൾ ഓക്കെ ആണെങ്കിൽ വി വിൽ സ്റ്റാർട്ട് വിത്ത് 2 o'clock. അല്ലെങ്കിൽ 3 o'clock യൂഷ്വൽ ടൈമിൽ തന്നെ. നോ പ്രോബ്ലം. 3 മതിയോ?
മതി.
ബാക്കി എല്ലാരും ബാക്കിയുള്ളവർ ആ തുടങ്ങി. ഹർഷിന് 2 മണിക്ക് വേണോ? ടു തേർട്ടി ആക്കണോ?